My name is Daniel Hill. I've been asked to moderate the debate today, though I am well aware that it'll need very little moderation. Our speakers know each other quite well, and we're very happy to have them both here to get together tonight. I'll introduce both speakers, and but before that, I'll quickly go through the format. Each speaker has an opening statement, and then each speaker has a rebuttal, then a counter-rebuttal, then there is a time for cross-examination, then there is a time for questions from the audience, and then finally closing statements from each speaker. I'll introduce each section very briefly, so I'll say Abdullah will now do the opening statement, for instance, just so you two are aware of that. There will be a bell at 2 minutes before the end of each speech, and a continuous bell at the end of each speech. Okay, well, let's kick off. I'm going to introduce both speakers now. To represent the Catholic side of the argument, so to speak, is Mr. Jason Sabalo. Jason is a graduate in liberal arts from Campion College, Australia. He's now studying philosophy at the University of Sydney. He's a convert to Catholicism, having been raised an atheist. He's from Canberra originally and a supporter of the Canberra Raiders, apparently. Apparently he's also a huge fan of Buffy the Vampire Slayer. More seriously, he's a member of the Dominican laity, among whom he is known as Brother Thomas Bartolo. To speak on the Islamic side of the argument, we have Mr. Abdullah Kund.
Is that how to pronounce it?
Very close.
Yeah, good.
Abdullah is a medical student and currently works part-time for an international humanitarian organisation. He's undertaking Islamic studies in Sydney with prominent local scholars and also via distance education. He lives with his wife and Corgi in Western Sydney and is a huge fan of Doctor Who and a member of the Parramatta and Essendon Football Club. No Buffy the Vampire Slayer there. Our timekeeper today is also Rachel Bell, so we thank her as well. The opening statement to start off, Mr. Jason Sabalo. Thank you.
I'd like to begin by bidding everyone a very good evening and thank you all for coming along for this debate on what is, I think we can all agree, a very important topic. We live in an age, particularly in the democratic West, of increasing interreligious dialogue, and particularly between Christians and Muslims, a period of growing interreligious cooperation. And on the whole, I think this is a good thing. That two great monotheistic religions, which so often in the past have been violently opposed to one another, and where, let's be honest, members of both sides have been guilty at times of demonisation and misrepresentation of the other, I think that this era of growing dialogue, growing understanding, growing friendship is something to thank God for. And I think it is a great thing that we are able to bear witness to the many great truths that we share in common. And I certainly think that in a period where the secular left is increasingly trying to drive all religion from the public square, it is not merely desirable but vital that we bear common witness on certain issues. When all is said and done, however, there remains what I hope no one will think me irreverent if I refer to as the Jesus question. And there is really no getting around this simple fact. It is absolutely fundamental to Christianity that Jesus of Nazareth was not merely a prophet, not merely an apostle of God, but was, as the Nicene Creed calls him, Deum de Deo, Lumen de Luminae, Deum Verum de Deo Vero. God of God, light from light, true God from true God. And equally, there can be no question the Quran is very clear in declaring that God does not beget nor is he begotten. From the Islamic point of view, the idea of Jesus as God is not merely mistaken, but is something that detracts from the unity and the dignity of God. And unless we're going to embrace a very illogical and irrational form of postmodernism, which I assume no one in this room would advocate, we have to acknowledge that we can't both be right. And I really don't see any way of getting around this fact. If we Christians are right, then the Muslims in the audience, as much as we may express our respect and affection for them, the Muslims are guilty of rejecting the claims of the one who has said, I am the way, the truth, and the light. And equally, we Christians, if the Muslims are right, we Christians are guilty of worshipping a man as God, which is rank idolatry. And so we come to the topic of tonight's debate. Before I go into detail as to presenting my reasons for believing that Jesus is God, I want to go into a bit of detail that may clear up a bit of confusion as to what exactly Christians and particularly Catholics mean when we call Jesus God. And I want to clarify two great Christian beliefs, which are perhaps sometimes misunderstood. Those great beliefs being the doctrines generally known as the Trinity and the Incarnation. Now, the Trinity, I want to be very clear, is the belief that there is one God, one being of God, but that within that one being, there exists eternally three persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the Trinity is not the belief that there is one God who is somehow three gods, nor that there is one person who is somehow three persons, either of which we would happily agree would be a contradiction. It is the belief that there is one God in three persons. And to quote a Protestant apologist who I know Abdullah has debated, a being is what makes something what it is, a person is what makes something who it is. So there is one what in God and three who's. This is the essential Christian belief. Secondly, the belief of the Incarnation is the belief that the second of the three persons of the Trinity became human, not in any way by ceasing to be God or by diminishing his divinity, but that the two natures were united into a single person, so that there is no smooshing together, no commingling of the natures. Each of the natures remains eternally distinct, but those two natures are united in the unity of a single person. And I suspect if Abdullah is going to argue what I think he's going to argue, I suspect I'll have opportunity to go into that in more depth in my rebuttal, but I'll just say that for now. So, it is one of the great truths of history that about 2,000 years ago, a movement arose of people who claimed that they had seen this man declare that he was God, declare that he would prove himself to be God by dying and rising again 3 days later, and that they saw him then, could go on to do so. And you may, whether you believe that claim or not, and whether you believe that Jesus made that claim or not, that from the very end of at least the first century AD, Jesus, the people who were calling themselves Jesus' followers, were proclaiming this to be the case. And if I were debating an atheist, I'd perhaps go into a bit more detail as to exactly why it was that people were willing to face persecution and even death, rather than renounce their claim that they had seen this man crucified and then risen again. As I said, if I were debating an atheist, I'd go into that in more detail, but I think for this audience, I'll simply note that fact. I simply note that I understand that it is the Muslim belief that Jesus preached nothing of his own day, he preached nothing of a death or crucifixion, and that this was a corruption that was introduced very early into the Christian church. But I want to make this point. We have documentary evidence of the beliefs of the church from very early on. We have the beliefs of the apostles recorded in the New Testament. We have the beliefs of very early church fathers going back into the first century after the time of Christ and from one end of the Roman Empire in the west to the other end in the east. And I've said to you, to Abdullah once, Abdullah and I debated one another last year at Parramatta, and I said then, and I'll say it again, and I hope I offend no one by saying this, but I respectfully submit that if Jesus' message was what Muslims believe it to be, If his message had nothing to do with his own deity or with his crucifixion, then so far from being a prophet, Jesus was one of the most failed and unsuccessful teachers who ever lived. Because it is so clear that within a generation of his leaving this earth, his followers, or at least those who believed themselves to be his followers, from one end of the Roman Empire to the other, were preaching this doctrine, and there were people who would be considered heretics or dissidents, most notably, for instance, the Gnostics. However, the Gnostics, so far from denying Jesus' divinity, denied his humanity, going so far as, for instance, to deny that Jesus had a body. And if you look historically, it is very difficult to find anyone who stands as a witness, who claims to be a follower of Jesus, but stands to this belief, as a witness to this belief, in Jesus as a merely human prophet. Now, I want to look a bit at the scriptural case, and I want to talk a bit, firstly, about what the Quran says. In Surah 5, Surah Al-Ma'idah, ayahs 46 and 47, and just, I hope Muslims will bear with me, I'll just explain for the benefit of the Christians in the audience, the Quran is divided into surahs, which are roughly the equivalent of what we would call chapters in the Bible, and these are subdivided into ayahs, which are roughly equivalent to what we would call verses. In Surah 5, ayahs 46 and 47, Muhammad talks about the giving of the Injil, Arabic for gospel, to Jesus, and then in 47, he declares that the Injil was inspired scripture, declares that in the Injil there is guidance and light. And then in Ayah 47 makes what I think is the very, very important statement. And he says, O people of the gospel, read in your gospels whether what we say is true. And he seems to me to be, in effect, setting us this very simple test to ask, to see whether, in fact, the Quran is true inspired revelation. Very simply, he is claiming that we should be able to check what he says against our Gospels and either confirm or deny this. Now, I should add, when I debated Abdullah last, if I understood Abdullah correctly, he seemed to feel that I had somehow misunderstood exactly what Muslims believe about the content of the Injil, and if I have done so, I certainly apologise, and I look forward to a clarification from Abdullah. But the point that seems to me very clear is that Muhammad believed that there were scriptures, books that existed in his time, and which were in the possession of the Christians of his time, against which his revelation could be checked and compared. And when, in fact, we check and compare it against the Gospels as they exist now and as we know they existed in the time of Muhammad, we get a very clear picture. That in point of fact, the Gospels, time and time again, point to the divinity of Christ. For instance, in the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 11, verse 27, Jesus declares that all things have been given by the Father over to me. That control and power over all things have been given by the Father to Jesus. And I must respectfully ask the Muslims in the audience to consider this simple question. Could I be a prophet make that declaration? But there is more. He goes on to say that nobody knows the Father except for the Son and those to whom the Son reveals him. And this, incidentally, is very clearly contrary to the claims of the Quran, which explicitly declares that, in fact, that Jesus did not know and understand the God who sent him. The Quran has Jesus declare, you know me, but I do not know and understand you. In the Gospels, Jesus clearly declares that he, in fact, knows the Father, and that no one else can know the Father but those to whom the Sons reveal him. Later on in the same Gospel, in chapter 28, verse 18, we see the Gospels being described as worshipping Jesus. And I ask you, I ask Muslims here, do you worship a prophet? If the answer is no, you must clearly declare that, in fact, the Gospels present Jesus as more than a prophet. He then goes on again to talk about how all things have been given to him. But I think the clearest and most beautiful declarations of who Jesus is are to be found in the Gospel according to St. John. In chapter 28 of that Gospel, the Jews, angered at some of the things that Jesus has been saying about himself, ask him, "You are not yet 50 years old, and yet have you seen our father Abraham?" Jesus declares, "Before Abraham was, I am." Now, you may notice there's a bit of a rather noticeable change there in tense. Before Abraham was, past tense, I am. And I'm sure all those of us who are familiar with the revelation of the Old Testament understand why. I'm sure most of you will be familiar with the story of the burning bush, where Moses, standing before the holy God, asks to know that God's name and is told, "I am what I am." And there can be no question, lest anyone thinks Jesus' words here at all ambiguous. They were certainly not ambiguous in the eyes and ears of his hearers, who immediately took up stones with the intention of casting stones at him as a blasphemer, because they fully understood the import of his words and fully understood what he was saying. And lest there be any doubt at all, two chapters later, St. John chapter 10, Jesus declares, "I and the Father are one." Again, the Jews take up stones with the intention of stoning him. And Jesus asks them, "For what good work have I done that you are seeking to stone him?" And they declare, "It is not for any good work that we are seeking to stone you. We are doing this because you have made yourself equal with God." And so, my friends, I submit to you that if we take the Quran at its word, if we compare what is claimed in the Quran with the clear words of the Gospels, we will come to this very simple and clear truth. The Quran fails its own test. The Gospels testify and testify clearly to who Jesus is, and who he is God. One final point that I wish to make. If Jesus is, as Christians believe him to be, God, and if, as Christians believe, God has suffered on the cross, then God as man has suffered. And this, I humbly suggest to you, opens up to us a deeper understanding of that great mystery of human suffering that is possible on any other worldview. Now, it is part of the lot of humanity to suffer. I'm sure everybody in this room has experienced suffering at some time, some more of us than others. And obviously, anyone who believes in God and believes in providence and divine will can, in some sense, understand that suffering as an expression of God's plan. But I submit to you that if you believe that Jesus was God, and if you believe that God as man has undergone suffering in our likeness, then our suffering has a dignity, a preeminence, that our suffering can be offered up to God in union with his. And I'd like to say to you, I'm sure amongst the Muslims here in the room tonight, there are those of you who have experienced some great suffering or another and have perhaps wondered at its purpose and felt certain that there must be some greater purpose behind this. And I feel very strongly, particularly as we are moving towards that time of the liturgical year when Christians will very soon be celebrating the death of our Lord and Saviour, I feel very strongly, my Muslim friends, that God wants you to know that there is that depth and purpose to your suffering that your religion as it stands does not allow you to recognise, and there is a greater depth that God wishes you to call you to understand and to share with you. And so I will bring that my opening remarks to a close. I look forward to hearing what Abdullah will have to say. To the Muslims in the audience, I want to say this. Just before the debate, I hope you don't think me disrespectful, but I observed your prayers out the back there, and I have to say, I was very deeply impressed with your piety, your devotion, your reverence. It is very clear to me that you are people who have a desire to serve God, who have a desire for a knowledge of God. But I must respectfully submit to you that if you look at what your own religion teaches, if you look at your own holy book, you will find that it is inadequate to the full expression of the will of God. And that if you truly wish to know God as he is, and to serve him as he wishes to be served, and to worship him as he wishes to be worshipped, and I assume that is what we all very deeply want, then I call on you to look at the claims of Jesus, to remember those lines that I quoted from the Gospel of St. Matthew, that no one can truly know the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son reveals him. And it is my sincere prayer that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, will reveal the truth about himself and the truth about his Father to all of you this evening.
Thank you, Jason. Now I call on Abdullah to present his opening statement. You have to wait for the projector to behave itself, but it won't be on.
First the lights go out, now the lights don't come on. Daniel's shedding some light on the situation. I'll get started. Assalamu alaikum jameel wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and good evening to our Christian and miscellaneous guests. Thank you very much for coming. And look, I also share Jason's sentiment that this is a very important topic. A topic that, well, I have had the opportunity to speak about a couple of times now. I don't think we get to talk about enough, certainly not openly and frankly. And I'll say from the outset, first of all, that it's not my aim to offend anyone in the room. I may do that, but it's certainly not my aim, so please do bear that in mind. And the second thing is, I'm not presenting to you what I think is an alternative truth. I don't think there's any such thing as that. There's truth, and then there's something else. So please don't think that I'm just presenting something which is a second option or a third option or one of many. No, it's the only option, it's the only truth. And I think that we've started off on that platform, and we can certainly proceed on that platform. Beginning with a quote from the Quran, and for those of you that don't know, that is the holy scripture for us. And I'll just use all English to keep it not only simple for myself, but simple for you. The Quran says of Jesus that indeed there are those that say that the Messiah, son of Mary, is God. But these deny the truth, saying that Jesus himself said, O children of Israel, worship God alone, who is my sustainer as well as your sustainer. Behold, whoever ascribes divinity to any being beside God, unto him will God deny paradise, and his goal shall be the fire, and such evildoers will have none to support them. I see what I mean by I'm not presenting an alternative to truth, and we don't think that that's the case either. So, in order to get the debate kicked off, and I'm glad that Jason actually started with a couple of definitions, we need to be consistent with our definitions. So it's very important that when I'm using Christian terminology, I use it as it is used by the Christians and don't just get convenient with words. And it's also important that Jason does the same for us. Likewise, if we're going to quote one another's scripture, it's very important that we use the understanding that the respective side has of that scripture. It's all well and good for me to quote one or two lines out of the Christian scriptures and say, well, they obviously mean this. But if that's not the way that it's been understood for the last 2,000 years, well, it's very much a moot point, and vice versa. And this is all the process of talking to each other and not at each other, and indeed that's part of the ideal outcome of a debate, because most of us here are going to leave on whatever side that we came on in the first place, perhaps even all of us. So at the very least, we might as well get out of it an understanding of what the other side absolutely believes, and maybe then get a bit of an insight as to how we can work together for some common goods. But that's not the direct aim of tonight. The direct aim of tonight is for me to answer the question from the true perspective, is Jesus man or God? I'll start by saying that I'm not even really sure that that's the distinction for Christians, because really Christians don't just say that Jesus is God, they say that he's man also. And we've had Jason sort of summarise that a little bit, and perhaps we can nut it out a little bit more as we go on. So really, I'm not arguing that Jesus is not God, I'm arguing that he's not God or the God-man. I'm sort of arguing 2 points. I guess Jason's got a double on the other side. But look, we absolutely reject the idea that God could become a man, and I say could in the operative sense there. We reject the idea that he would need to. We reject the idea that it has some special meaning for salvation. We reject all of these ideas. And certainly, in the classical Chalcedonian presentation of the incarnation of the Trinity, we have many things to reject. So let's start with the Islamic definitions. What do I mean when I say God? What being am I talking about? Well, I'm talking about the necessary existence, the being through which all things that we now know, see, touch, etc., came into existence, and without which would not exist. Okay? We believe that he has necessary attributes, and they are that he is absolutely one, uniquely one, that he is without beginning, without end, that he is dissimilar to everything that we can perceive and imagine, that he has will, power, knowledge, life, sight, hearing, speech, and is self-subsistent. He needs nothing and no one to experience anything similar to what we experience. There are things in the realm of possibility for him, and they are only possible for him, and that is to create, to render into non-existence, and to fashion as he wills. And some of you would have heard the example that I've given before, because I do recognise a few familiar faces, but I'll give a different one today. I've got an MP3 player here that obviously belongs to someone, and if I wanted to render this into non-existence, I could not. Okay, now I could smash it to pieces, but it still exists, right? The parts of it still exist. I can't render it absolutely into non-existence. Okay? If I wanted to change it into a hat, I can't. Okay? I might be able to, I don't know, melt down the plastic and then weave it into a hat, but I can't absolutely change it without some mechanism into a hat. And if I wanted to create another one, I can't, unless I have the component parts. Okay? These are the things that are possible for God. We have no power over them whatsoever. Now, then things that are impossible, not impossible for God, but are impossible, are what I call the silly logical fallacies. Okay, so the idea, for example, that God is not really God if he doesn't stop all the bad stuff that happens in the world. Okay, or the idea that if God can't make a square a circle while keeping it a square, then he's not all-powerful. Okay, these are just logical fallacies because we're using terms which ultimately have no meaning. And when we use words that have no meaning, well then the conclusions that we come to are also meaningless. And I'll be touching on that a little bit later on once we get to the Muslim approach to the Trinity and the Incarnation. So looking at the Christian definitions as I understand them, and I think Jason sort of affirmed these for me, that God has an essence or a substance, a being, and that's what makes him what he is. And then there's the persons, or who he is. And when we talk about Jesus specifically, he himself has two unique natures, otherwise known as the hypostatic union, a divine nature and a human nature, not half man, half God, fully God and fully man, and that these natures do not mix. That's the Christian understanding that I'll be using as I go on from here. So why do we believe what we believe as Muslims? Well, quite simply, the existence of the creation indicates the Creator. It's very obvious that everything that exists is dependent upon something else. So me, for example, you know that I would have had two parents, okay? There are some exceptions to that in history, obviously, one which we would agree on. I obviously had two parents, they each had two parents, and so on and so on and so on. And eventually they would get back to something, okay? And we could go back and back and back, even if we want to use the secular evolutionist point of view, back and back to, you know, primordial life forms, back and back to, you know, basic protein molecules, back and back to individual atoms, back and back to the Big Bang, okay? Everything that we perceive is reliant upon something that came before it, okay? So we say that there would have to be something which was not reliant upon something else. Otherwise we'd have an infinite regression, and that does not make sense, given that the reality of time, for example, even exists. Also, the necessary attributes we say are essential for the Creator, at least because of the nature of the creation itself. And I've already briefly outlined what I mean about impossible. Okay, so is God all powerful? Can He create a rock so big that He can't lift it? Right? And people love to ask this question. It's not clever. It's just silly. You know, you're using words that have no meaning, and your conclusion therefore has no meaning. Okay? Tell that to someone next time they ask you that question. You can quote me if you feel a bit embarrassed about it. So we have some quotes here from the Quran that affirm each of these attributes. We don't need to go through each individually, but certainly the critical ones that are different, between our understandings and when it comes to the incarnation or Jesus being God and man, is that there is nothing like unto Him, and that He is the absolutely uniquely one. And here's an oft-quoted verse from the Quran. God, there is no deity save Him, the ever-living, the self-subsistent, fount of all being. Neither slumber nor sleep overtakes Him. His is all that exists in the heavens and the earth. Who is there that could intercede with Him, unless it is by His permission? He knows all that lies open before men and all that is hidden from them, whereas they cannot attain to aught of His knowledge save that which He wills them to attain. His eternal power reaches over the heavens and the earth, and their maintenance wearies Him not, and He alone is truly exalted tremendous. That's our Nicene Creed. So, why do we reject the incarnation? Well, the simple answer is that it makes no sense. Okay, it makes no sense. And the reason for that is that a Christian would affirm that Jesus the Messiah has a human nature and a divine nature. Okay? And as I said, that these natures are unique and that they don't mix. And I've even heard the statement, I think it's appropriated from St. Thomas Aquinas, that Jesus is divine in His divine nature and human in His human nature. Okay? Now, for us, this makes absolutely no sense. So if we start from, for example, the issue of the Messiah being in a hypostatic union, okay, so being unified with the human nature. Did this action come about through the substance of God, or did it come about through one of the individual hypostases of God? So did the Father bring it about? Did the Son bring it about Himself? Did the Spirit bring it about? If it's an action of the substance, okay, then the hypostases themselves have no creative action, and therefore their individual persona are irrelevant. If it is an action of the Father, say in conjunction with the Spirit, then they have a unique power that the Son does not have. And if it is an action of the Son, then the Son becoming the Messiah is effectively irrelevant. Okay? Now that may not make much sense at the moment, but it will as we go on and give more examples. And here's a quote from the Quran that refutes the idea of God taking on any offspring. That isn't directed purely at Christians, it's directed at any religion that has that as a concept. Now we could then look at the nature of the birth of Jesus. And obviously the true idea is that His birth was natural, however, He did not have a father. When I say true, I guess for the Christians you can translate that as the Islamic idea. The Christian idea is that He was born, and at His birth and conception, the hypostatic union came into place. Okay. However, the issue here is that you would affirm that the Messiah is eternal, but the human nature is not eternal. Okay? You also affirm that the Messiah is fully human and fully divine. Okay? So he's got these mutually exclusive attributes which cannot exist in the individual person. Okay? A human being is not eternal, and you affirm that. And again, it's not conceivable that God should have begotten himself a son. Limitless is he in his glory. When he wills a thing to be, he says to it, be, and it is. What about the death of the Messiah? Well, we have a pretty easy get-out clause. We say that the Messiah didn't die, that he's being rescued into heaven. Now, the problem with the Christian idea here is that if the Messiah had to die to bring about the salvation of humanity, then when you say Messiah, you mean the human nature and the divine nature. Okay? But how could a divine nature die? Right? What exactly does that mean? If you want to say, no, it was just the human nature, then the Messiah didn't die. Okay, the human nature did, but the divine nature didn't, and therefore the Messiah was actually alive in one nature. Okay? The other question then to ask would be, if the divine nature did die, okay, so the Messiah as a whole died, human nature and divine nature, well then how could the substance of God exist without one of his essential personalities? Therefore, that would say that that personality is an essential. Okay. Now, the point that I'm getting at through all of this, in simple terms, is that ultimately we come to a stopgap where the conclusion that you have indicates some deficiency in God. And straight away, we would say that that can't be God. Whatever is deficient cannot be God. So even if we were to take your idea on board and say, yes, God is divided, not divided, pardon me, but it has three personalities, and the Son took on human form, and as the Messiah he died on the cross for us in human and divine nature, we would then say, well, the Son is irrelevant, so we won't worship the Son. We'd only worship the Spirit and the Father. Okay? Unless God has those attributes that we spoke about, we don't consider him to be God. And again, there's a quote from the Quran refuting the crucifixion. And again, the same problem comes up with the resurrection. How did the resurrection come about? Did the Son do it himself? If that's the case, then the Father and Spirit weren't necessary in the plan for salvation. Did the Son need to rely on the Father and the Spirit? Okay, if that's the case, well, then the Son's reliant. And again, we would not worship him, okay, because he must be self-subsistent. And if it was the substance of God itself, without any involvement from the individual personalities, then they are not necessary. And again, we would say that we would worship God. O men, it is you who stand in need of God, whereas he alone is beyond needing the assistance of others, the one to whom all praise is due. So, ultimately, there are a couple of questions I think that Christians need to ask themselves. The first one is, can you really say Jesus is Lord? Well, you can, but you need to also affirm the rest of what you affirm. You need to say, he's Lord and servant. He's God and man. Okay? He's eternal and temporal. He's independent and dependent. Okay? You can't just say one or the other. Because if you say one, if you just say Jesus is Lord, eternal, independent, then that's just the same as us saying he's temporal, dependent, and man. You see what I mean? Unless you're affirming exactly what you affirm, then there's no point to it. So you would have to say, if you're not saying both of these attributes simultaneously, that he's a man, servant of God, temporal and subordinate creation. And indeed, that's the true position. What about as the Messiah with the divine and the human natures? Did he ever perform an action? Did the Messiah ever perform an action? So for example, in the Gospel according to Mark, when Jesus is quoted as saying that no one knows the hour, not even the Son. Who's speaking there? It can't be the divine nature, because if he was divine, he would know. So that must have only been the human nature speaking at that time. Okay? When he got hungry, as is reported in the Gospels, and he ate, that could not have been the divine nature. Okay? But when he says things like, I and the Father are one, that cannot be the human nature. Okay, because the Father doesn't have a human nature. It can only be the divine nature. So what exactly did this Messiah, who was made up of two natures, do? He didn't do anything. The divine nature did some things, the human nature did some things, but the Messiah as a whole did nothing. And that's just summarising those. We then need to go on and ask other questions. If we're going to say he's fully man, well then could he have got married? Could he have fathered a child? Okay, they're attributes of someone being fully human. And if he could have fathered a child, well then he could have been a father himself. So he'd be a son and a father. Okay? Again, these are questions that you need to answer. We don't need to answer them. Okay, because we don't affirm these sorts of attributes. And that's the quote that we went through at the beginning, saying that those who affirm this idea that Jesus is God are denying the truth. And look, it's fine to question. Sorry, is that the end? Or is that?
No, 2 minutes.
2 minutes ago, thank you. It's fine to question, okay? And the Quran wants you to question. It doesn't want you to just take what I say on face value. But you do need to think about evidence. What evidence can you use? Okay? And sometimes you'll ask questions like, well, how can God be relational? How can he love if he didn't exist in the Trinity, in eternity? You know, how can he be all just and all merciful if he didn't have this plan? Well, these are questions that you ask from a created mindset, trying to constrict an uncreated God into a created box. To add to that, you could then present some ideas like, well, Jesus claimed to be God, so he's either Lord, liar, or lunatic. And I'd say, well, no, he could be legend, labelled, or laconic, to the point of being misunderstood. See, this is a fallacy that not even alliteration can protect. Right? It doesn't need to be those three options, Lord, liar, lunatic. There's many other options, you know, and only limited by my poor vocabulary, basically. What about the Gospels? The Gospel accounts, are they genuinely reliable in presenting this idea? In Mark's Gospel, Jesus is referred to always as Rabbi. In Matthew's Gospel, he's referred to as Lord. Okay? In Mark's Gospel, when the writer is referring to Jesus calming the sea of Galilee, the disciples say, "Do you not care that we are going to die?" Okay? And they call him Rabbi. In the same story in Matthew, they say, "We are going to die without you, Lord." Yeah, these are implying pretty different things. Why is it that only John's Gospel has the I am statements, which I don't think are really that clear anyway, but I'll talk about that in my rebuttal. Why is it that the Gospel accounts that I just spoke about the calming of the Sea of Galilee, refer to Jesus then landing at Gadara or Gerasa, both locations which are over 20 kilometres away from the Sea of Galilee? What makes them any more reliable than a Harry Potter novel? Honestly. Thank you very much. I'll stop there because I don't want to go over time.
Thank you, Abdullah. I do apologise for the few technical errors that have occurred so far. That's beyond our control, but I think we've got it sorted. I call upon Jason to present his 10-minute rebuttal.
I'd like to thank Abdullah for his opening statement, and I'd like to say up front that I certainly agree with a lot of what he says about what is necessary for an open and meaningful dialogue. And certainly whatever else we may disagree about, we agree that there can only be one truth, that when you're saying things that are logically contradictory to one another, they can't both be right. So it's good that at least some of the sillier aspects of postmodern philosophical academia, which as a philosophy student here at Uni of Sydney I have to deal with from time to time, can be safely left out of the room here. I also appreciate what Abdullah says about quoting one another's scriptures accurately and referring to the interpretations that, you know, of one side's scriptures that side's used. As I said in my opening speech, if I have misunderstood something in terms of how you understand the Quran, I certainly look forward to being able to clarify that and to hear more about that in Abdullah's rebuttal. But I actually, in terms of rebutting, found myself in agreement with at least half of what Abdullah was saying. The vast majority of what he said about the nature of God, about the attributes that God intrinsically must have within himself, were things that I found myself, and particularly where he talks about the reasons why the fact that there is a creation shows that there must be a creator, I found myself very impressed by. Daniel mentioned in his introduction to me that I'm a lay Dominican, and that amongst the lay Dominicans I go by the name Brother Thomas Bartolo. I have to say, there was so much in Abdullah's speech that, speaking not merely as a Christian, not merely as a Catholic, but as a Dominican and a Thomist, that I found very impressive. And I have to say, Abdullah and I have a mutual friend who just took up a vocation with the Dominican Sisters and who I know is praying for us all tonight. And I think she'll be very pleased to hear some of what Abdullah had to say. But there comes a point, of course, where he suggests that fundamentally the Christian claims about not merely that it did happen, but the possibility, even the possibility, of the human and the divine natures being united into a single person, Abdullah argues, is impossible. And he starts asking questions, for example, well, was the incarnation the work of a single, was it just the work of the Son, was it the work of the divine person? And actually, I think the scriptures, and still more so the Christian creeds, are very clear on this point. It was an act of all three people, but not merely an act of the divine nature. It was the second person of the Trinity became man through the action of the Holy Spirit. St. Luke's Gospel tells us that it is the Holy Spirit which overshadowed the Virgin, causing her to become pregnant, at the command of the Father. So actually, I think Abdullah was presenting us there with a bit of a false dichotomy, because it was an action of all three persons, but it was an action wherein each of the three persons took on a fundamentally different role. And Abdullah's question, well, why couldn't one of the other persons have become man, or why couldn't, in fact, were two of the persons superfluous? In point of fact, this is perfectly true. One of the three persons of the Trinity could have created, saved, redeemed the world by himself, if that was the decision that God in his triune majesty had made. As it in fact happens, it was the decision of God in his triune majesty that each of the three persons would take on specific roles in creation and salvation. But that need not logically have been the case. But as I said, what in fact happened was that all three persons were involved. The Son became, as I said, became human through the power of the Spirit at the will and command of the Father. So all three were involved, but fundamentally different roles. Now, a lot of the other suggestions that Abdullah put up as attempting to point out logical contradictions, I think it's possible that he has ever so slightly misunderstood how Christians understand the relationship. Each nature remains who and what it is. The Father remains, the divine nature has the qualities that the divine nature has. But human nature is united in a single person. So the person who is Jesus has in fact eternally existed. That person is joined to a nature which is temporary, that turns to a nature which might not have existed, to a nature which had a beginning point. However, the person itself does not thereby acquire those qualities, because the person is fully divine. Therefore, I would submit there is no logical contradiction between asserting the conditional nature of the divine sonship against the eternality and necessity of the person. And some of the questions that Abdullah was asking was, well, if the man did it, then it wasn't really God doing it. Well, actually, no. If I pick up something with my left hand, if I pick up my Android, I picked up my Android. However, my left hand did it, my right hand didn't. Now, I think this is perhaps most clearly brought out in the question of what do we Christians believe happened at the death of Jesus. Now, what happened was that the human nature underwent death. And what does death mean? Well, fundamentally, death means the separation of the body from the spirit. Jesus had a divine nature. That divine nature is united eternally to a human soul and a human body. At the death of Christ, the human soul and human body were separated from one another, just as yours and my bodies and souls will be separated on the day that we die. However, and here's the thing, so therefore, but natures don't die, persons die. Therefore, when the human soul was separated from the human body, the person who is the second person of the Trinity truly experienced and underwent death. That in no way, however, is contradictory to the claim that the eternal nature of the second person of the Trinity was eternally and remained eternal, what it is and has always been. So during all the period when our Lord was in the tomb, the second person of the Trinity was governing the universe as he always has done, along, of course, with the other two persons. And as I said, I think what we've possibly had here is a failure to understand exactly what the Church teaches about the way in which the two natures are distinct, but the persons united. And so I think if you fully attempt, and I'll be honest, there can be no question that the claims of the Trinity and of the Incarnation are difficult things to get your head around. But I honestly think that if you keep fully in mind that distinction between nature and person, and if you understand the fact that it is in fact possible for one of the two natures to undergo something, and therefore, because the nature is of the person undergoes what that one nature undergoes, but the other nature remains eternally what it was, then most of the contradictions that Abdullah speaks about are in a large degree cleared up. And with that, I thank you for your attention and look forward to hearing Abdullah's rebuttal.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Jason, for your openness and frankness, and also thank you to the non-Muslim audience. I mean, the reality is I did just draw an analogy between your scripture and works of English fiction, and I heard not even a gasp, so I appreciate that very much. I'll just start with the way that I'm sort of understanding part of Jason's argument. It is that he sort of started by saying, well, the Quran tells Christians to look to the Bible because it's true, and therefore the Bible says that Jesus is God, ergo, Jesus must be God, according to what our own scripture says. I'll come back to that point, but the simple reality is that it's just a basic misunderstanding of Quranic exegesis. I want to rather go through a couple of Jason's points in order. I was very interested to see that he used the Nicene Creed as the basis for referring to the understanding of Jesus and his divinity, and then, in contrast, quoted the Quran for us. Well, I don't think that these are really equal, and it shows to me a problem that exists in Christianity. See, if you want to quote something that's comparable to the Quran, I mean, for sure, you would assume that you would go to the Bible, right? And it's very interesting that Jason sort of followed that idea on by saying that the earliest followers of Jesus held this idea and that there's evidence of that. Well, I would ask, where is the evidence for the Chalcedonian Creed existing in, or anything similar to it, existing in the first century CE, as Jason said that it does? In fact, I would say that even the Gospel accounts themselves, particularly the Synoptics, repeatedly say that the disciples of Jesus did not understand. They didn't get it. So, I mean, really, I'm not sure where this early evidence is coming from, but that's the first question that I put forward to him. The second question, or I guess challenge that I put forward, is that ultimately the whole idea relies on a reduplicative argument. Okay, the idea that we're affirming two separate things about one thing or one person. So I could, for example, say that I am a licensed driver and I am a brother. Okay, I hold both of these attributes. Now, I don't get to drive a car legally because I am a brother. Okay, and I don't have siblings because I am a licensed driver. Right, these are mutually exclusive attributes. Okay, the problem with using that in the case of Jesus and his divinity, that style of argument, is that the attributes themselves are contradictory. Okay, so to say that he's divine in his divine nature and human in his human nature, that seems to make sense on the surface, but ultimately you're affirming that he's divine and human, which is contradictory. Okay, to say that I'm a brother and a licensed driver, yes, they're separate attributes, but they don't contradict one another. Right? I can be a brother and be a licensed driver simultaneously. Okay, so this reliance on reduplicative argument is not only quite false in the end, because it's not correctly using the style of argument, but it means that ultimately the whole concept of God comes down to affirming mutually exclusive things. Okay, which I think is a little bit difficult for Christians to maintain, but I'll be very interested in what Jason has to say about that. Now, Jason also said that if indeed the Quranic understanding of Jesus, i.e. that he was purely human with no divine attributes, is true, well then he was one of the most failed and unsuccessful teachers in all of humanity's history. Well, I think some of the lecturers here would beg to differ, or at least their students would anyway. Having said that, the reality is, as I said, the Gospels themselves affirm that the disciples did not understand. Now, this isn't a statement that's made once or twice and in one Gospel account and not in the others. It's made in all four Gospel accounts, and it's made repeatedly that the disciples themselves did not understand. So what the followers of the disciples thought is kind of irrelevant to me, because the very accounts that were apparently written by them or written by their students indicate that they themselves did not understand, you know, what was being taught. That likewise, just because the teaching does not carry on does not mean that the teacher themselves failed. Okay? It means that the students failed. All right? When I get up and lecture some kids on basic HSC chemistry, if they all then go and fail the HSC exam, that's not my fault. Okay, if they didn't put in the study, if they didn't understand, that's an indication of their failure, not my failure. So again, I'd say that linking this idea of failurehood to Jesus because the disciples allegedly and the followers of them didn't get that he was purely human is a fallacy. Now, coming back to the Quran and why this is a false exegesis, the Quran refers to concepts in multiple ways. And I guess in simple terms, the idea that we have of the Quran is that the Quran explains itself. Okay? So for example, the Quran will refer to the death of the Pharaoh of Moses, peace be upon him. And it then also refers to the body of Pharaoh being saved. Okay? Now people say, well, this is a contradiction. Well, no, it's one verse explaining the concept. Okay, so the concept is that Pharaoh died, and then the verse about Pharaoh's body, his physical body being saved, is then explaining more detail about the concept. So we believe that the Quran explains itself. So yes, there is a verse in the Quran that says, O people of the book, look to the scripture that you have between your hands. Okay. There's also a verse that says, the people of the book change the words from their places, okay, meaning that the script has changed. And there's also another verse which states that the Quran is Muhaymin, that it is the witness, the protector of the earlier scriptures, and that the way that you work out what it's protecting is to see what in the earlier scriptures still corresponds to the Quran. Okay? So you need to put all of these three verses together to come up to the understanding of what the Quran is actually saying. You can't just pick one. Okay? The equivalent to that would be me quoting Jesus when he's saying in a parable that a king said, bring those who do not recognize my kingship before me, and I'll kill them, or kill them before me. Okay. Now I could quote that one line and say, "See, Jesus said, whoever doesn't believe in him, he wants to kill him." But we know that that's not the case, okay? Because the earlier verses and the latter verses explain it. The following verses, right? So it's the same with the Quran. okay? And I'm not being convenient. Now, I'll just jump over to the ego I me statements, the I am statements in John. Ego I me is just Greek for I am I exist, my existence. Now, to link this to the quotes in Exodus and Deuteronomy is a very big stretch indeed, and I'm quite surprised that Christians continue to do it, because the reality is that you're combining a Septuagint translation, that is a Greek translation of the Hebrew Scriptures, as well as the Hebrew, original Hebrew, of the Hebrew Scriptures, and what's then said in the New Testament, and kind of combining it all together and saying that it's linked. It's not, okay? In the Septuagint, God said to Moses, ego I me ho on, I am the one, okay? In the Masoretic text, the closest that we have to the original Hebrew, God says to Moses, ayah asher ayah, okay? I am what I am, or I will be what I will be, okay? Now, what we then do is get the Greek, ego I me ho on, I am the one, and then ayah asher ayah, I am what I am, combine them together, and then say, well, when Jesus said I am, that's what he meant. Well, no, you're combining two different translations and hoping that it draws a conclusion. I think that is a very big fallacy as well. I guess ultimately, the challenge that one would have to face in order to answer this question from the Christian perspective, to demonstrate evidence for it, would be to do exactly that. My contention, and the contention of Muslims, is that Jesus was a man. Now, I don't even need to provide much evidence for this, because the reality that men were born in Palestine 2,000 years ago is historical fact, otherwise we wouldn't exist today, right? I don't need to provide evidence for that. But if you want to support the concept that a man was born who also had a divine nature, okay, you need to provide some significant evidence for that. And at the moment, I'm not seeing much but logical fallacies and quotes from Scripture which, at best, are ambiguous. Thank you very much.
We now come to the, I suppose, the middle part of tonight's proceedings. Each speaker has a 5-minute counter rebuttal, so I call Jason to give his counter rebuttal.
Okay, I'll have to be brief. Abdullah asks the question of, well, where were these people making these clear statements of Jesus's divinity early on? I'd point you to Melito of Sardis, bishop of the city of Sardis, very early in the second century, who in his famous Easter sermon referred to Jesus as the God of Israel and said, "This one is God." I would refer you to Ignatius of Antioch, the great bishop of Antioch, martyred probably in the year 110 AD, whose letters specifically refer to our Lord and God, Jesus Christ. I could refer you to St. Clement of Rome, martyred either very early 1st or very early 2nd century. I perhaps should apologise, I should have gone into that in more detail in in my opening statement. But the simple fact is that yes, if you look at the patristic record, and I would challenge those who, you know, the writings of the early Christian fathers are online, and the fact that my original assertion, you know, from one end of the Roman Empire to the other, the early Christians truly did believe that Jesus was God. Secondly, Abdullah asked the question of, you know, the combination of attributes, and saying that being God requires eternality, being human requires non-eternality, being God requires necessity, being human requires non-necessity, and says that the attributes contradict, and he accused me of using a bit of a false analogy in defending them. But what I think, again, Abdullah missed is that the person, that whilst there are two natures, there is one person, and that person, we unhesitatingly affirm, is eternal. That person, we unhesitatingly affirm, is necessary in his existence. That person, we unhesitatingly affirm, is uncreated. The person was united to a human nature The divine nature was united to a human nature, and the human nature had those limited attributes. But those attributes apply only to the created nature that was taken on. They are not they do not, in that sense, apply to the person, and they do not change the fact that the second person of the Trinity had eternally these qualities. Time is short. I'm probably not going to have a chance to answer everything Abdullah asked. We perhaps I'll get onto some of it in question and answer. But a funny question, the ego army statements, and Abdullah's asking the question that, you know, why did, you know, suggesting that, you know, we're making a bit much of these statements. Simple, I refer you back to what I said in my original statements. How did the Jews take them? Okay? They took stones up with the purpose of stoning him. When Jesus asked, why are you doing this? They replied, because you have made yourself equal with God. His hearers, the people who actually spoke the language that he was speaking in, did not consider his language ambiguous. They didn't ask him for a clarification. And he, when they took up stones to stone him, didn't say, no way, you misunderstood me. I put it to you very simply that the reason for this is quite simple. His hearers took up stones to kill him because they thought he was claiming to be God, and the reason he didn't correct them is because they had understood him properly. As I said, the issue of the Quranic understanding of the Injil is a very important one, certainly far too important for the minute I have left. We will hopefully take that up in Q&A. I would reiterate this point. The eternity of the person is not affected by the fact that a non-eternal nature has been taken on and taken into that person. And therefore, I respectfully submit that the logical contradiction that Abdullah is talking about does not exist.
I now call Abdullah to give his 5-minute counter rebuttal.
Thank you again, Jason. I'll probably leave some of my points as well for the cross-examination and Q&A, but I just do want to note, and it's not being petty, because it was critical to your argument, that you did initially say that there were first century examples of Christians having this idea about Jesus' divinity, and each example that you've then quoted, their writings are dated to the second century. And that is critical, you know, because that's separating almost 100 years from Jesus the man to when these ideas were even written down. As I said, ultimately, the idea that there can be two unique attributes in an individual and that they are not contradictory is what we call a reduplicative argument, okay? But the problem lies when those attributes themselves do actually contradict. And we would agree that divine is made up of X, Y, Z, that human is made up of N, E, I, and that they are not comparable, things. And to merely just say that divine with regard to divine nature and human with regard to human nature, I honestly do think it's just a logical cop-out, and it really is ignoring the basic principles of terminology and discussion. Not to say, though, not to disregard, that the best Christian theologians have really worked hard at trying to explain that issue. As I said in my first rebuttal, and I'll say again now, ultimately the challenge comes down to the Christians. Okay, it's very easy for us to affirm that Jesus, a man, was born in Palestine about 2,000 years ago, and that he did certain things, and that then he ascended into heaven. Okay. Now, for us, we only ultimately, in terms of if we wanted to discuss it with a purely secular individual, have to talk about the concept of there possibly being a virgin birth, and then talk about the concept of the ascension into heaven. Okay, in terms of a human being existing in Palestine, that would not be something that anyone would really debate. It is a reality. Okay, but to say that the God-man existed in Palestine about 2,000 years ago, and all the associated Christian salvation theology that comes from that, requires evidence. Now, what Jason ultimately then relied upon in his second rebuttal then was some quotes from the Gospel according to John. Now, as I said earlier, why are these statements not found in any other Gospel account? We know that the Gospel writers did not write these books under the assumption that one day someone else is going to fill in all the gaps and that will be collected into a collection of books called the New Testament. We know that that's not the case. Okay, so why did Mark not write a single I am statement? Why did Matthew not write a single I am statement? Why did Luke not write one? If they're so critical, why do they not exist in any of these other accounts? So if it is so critical that, in fact, Christian salvation and indeed theology hinges effectively on these statements, why do we only find them in one book? I think that that's a question also that needs to be asked. But I'll refer to the base challenge, which is provide evidence for the claim. That's ultimately what we need to do tonight to reach some point of conclusion. Thank you very much.
We now reach the point where each speaker will cross-examine the other. After this, there will be questions from the audience. Now, now's the time that people here may be formulating some question. I just want to explain how we're going to proceed with questions. First of all, questions need to be questions, and I will make the final call on whether they are or not. So if anybody speaks for more than 20 seconds, then you're overstaying your welcome. A question should be less or equal to 20 seconds. I will be taking questions alternately. So the first question will be, as the order has run, the first question will be directed to Jason, the second question to Abdullah. And the questions will be asked from this lectern. So if you are planning on a question, formulate it, and I would appreciate if you would come and line up the front. Two lines, the line closest to the tables for Jason and the line closest to the back wall for Abdullah, and I'll call you alternately. So just be aware of that. We've got plenty of time for questions, so please ask one if you wish. Abdullah, according to my running sheet, Abdullah will be cross-examining Jason first. Is that correct?
That's my mistake.
Now, how would you like to do it? You both have microphones. You can do it from your chairs if you like. Otherwise, one can stand here.
Keep it a bit more relaxed. I'm packing on a nest egg for the future, so standing up is going to impact that, isn't it? I was very pleased to hear you say at the start, Jason, that in terms of society in general, we're sort of stuck at the moment between extremist secular liberalists on one side, and you didn't say this, but maybe I'm putting words into your mouth, but I hope that you'll agree with me, ultra-conservative, economic right on the other side, And so here we are in the middle, trying to affirm a religious, socially just identity, and some may say that this question that we're talking about tonight doesn't really need to be had to deal with those issues, but I disagree. I think that it does, and I'm sure that you would agree, at least in principle as well. Getting on to a couple of the points that I think stem from that, you said that through God's suffering, being crucified, that then gives some majesty to our own suffering, some honour to our own suffering. Now, I ask, first of all, did the divine person, sorry, the divine nature of the one person, pardon me, even I'm getting confused now, did that nature experience the suffering? If so, I'd ask how, because I'd say that the mechanism for that suffering is through the human nature. And do we really need to have a God that experiences things the way we do in order for there to be value in what we experience?
Okay, to answer the first part of your question, absolutely not. The Christian creeds are very clear that God is impassible. God cannot experience suffering. And indeed, St. Thomas, I'm sure, would say that since God is the ultimate good and suffering is an evil, it is impossible for the divine nature to experience suffering. So I think we're probably agreed that far. As to the question, does God have to experience what we experience it for it to have some value? No, absolutely not. I think I did actually acknowledge that it is possible for God, that even if you did not believe in the incarnation, you could acknowledge suffering as having some role in the divine plan. Having said that, what I would argue is that the Christian, the beliefs of the belief, certainly the Catholic belief, I imagine some of our separated brethren would agree with us, some wouldn't, but certainly the Catholic belief that about the possibility of uniting our sufferings to those of Christ and offering them up to him, though that's not necessary for them to have meaning, but I would argue that it does give them a depth of meaning that they would not otherwise have.
Thank you for that. I'll now ask, look, this isn't meant to be funny, so I apologise if it comes across that way, but I'm genuinely looking for, a bit of a Catholic exegesis on this. It's very easy to get secular liberals and even Protestants to comment, but I haven't heard a Catholic comment before. You quoted the Gospel according to Matthew where Jesus says that the Father has given him all things. Now, if we then look at the Gospel according to Mark, Jesus quite clearly says there that he does not have knowledge of the hour. Now, for me, that implies a contradiction. And the questions that I would ask from that would be, did he mean most things, or did he mean power in Matthew, or did Mark just get it wrong? That he didn't actually say that, because we do know that in the parallel story in Matthew, it doesn't say that the son doesn't know. It doesn't say that the son does know the hour, but it doesn't expressly say that he doesn't know either. So I'm interested to know, how does the Catholic reconcile these apparently contradictory statements, and what bearing do you think that has on A, the value of the Gospels themselves as truth, and B, evidence for Jesus' divinity?
Well, certainly, since I believe the Gospels to be the Word of God, it will hopefully not surprise you to say that no, I don't think so. Mark got it wrong. What do I think is happening here? I would agree with the exegesis of Pope St. Gregory the Great, who reigned around 600 AD. Basically, the Gospels, I would argue, frequently speak of what Christ knows or is able to do through his human nature. In his human nature, in his divine nature, he knows all things. But nonetheless, as a human, because of his desire to experience humanity and to unite himself to the ordinary flow of humanity, he went through the process of learning things. So St. Luke's Gospel talks about him growing in knowledge and wisdom. So what St. Gregory argues, and what I would affirm, is there that Christ is saying, I do not know this through my human nature, and there is no way that any mere creature could know, and therefore you as the apostles should not be concerned with this. And as an aside, that I really wish that certain Christians who think that they can calculate the date of Christ's return would please get that message. that this is not something that it is for creatures to know. But I don't think we can read from that Christ as a person was denying that he knew the day and the hour.
So you've already said that Christ had a human soul, and that was separated from the body at death. I'll come back to that towards the end of this question. I just wanted to give that as a preface. Now, what you seem to be saying in that answer is that he also has two minds, or at least two attributes of knowledge. He's got the human attribute of knowledge, which we would, I guess, understand to be the mind, for, you know, in simple terms. And then he's also got a divine attribute of knowledge. Now, I guess, and we also know that God has a spirit, so therefore one would assume, after you've said that he has a human soul, that he has a divine spirit also. So I guess what I would draw from that, if I was reading that on paper, would be that, in fact, in the person of Jesus, there are also two separate, independent persons, and then we could say that, well, the Trinity isn't really just three persons, it's kind of four. And then we could add to that further, to add on to a comment that you made where you said that the plan for salvation, i.e. the second person of the Trinity taking on human form and suffering and dying, was God's decision, the decision of the substance. Now, well, then I'd ask again, that the terminology seems to be a little bit, you know, difficult for simple people like me to grasp, because when we're talking about the hypostases being personalities, we're also now talking about the substance sort of having a personality as well. And I guess that this inherently for me is the problem, that, you know, we're getting very caught up in terms and trying to define them, but by the time we define what is a person and what is a substance, we then jump back and have to do it again. So I guess the question that I'm asking is, and then obviously this will probably be the last one, does it not sort of indicate that the individual natures within Jesus were also independent persons if they don't share the basic attributes of what personhood is?
Okay, first of all, let me say, having debated you twice and having watched you debate others, in describing yourself as a very single person, you're selling yourself short. But having said that, I'll have to give a very quick answer because I realise Rachel's about to bring me off. But I'll say this. The traditional language certainly used by St. Thomas is that he possesses two intellects, a human intellect and a divine intellect. So there are two intellects through which the person knows, but what I would argue is there is only one person who actually knows. So he has two intellects which are the source of his knowledge, but there is the one person and that one person who possesses the knowledge. And that is why I would say that it is in fact rightly called one person. As you're probably aware, there was in fact an early Christological heresy called Nestorianism, which essentially held two persons, the divine and the human, that were somehow loosely united. But I would say two intellects through which knowledge comes, one person who in fact has the knowledge. Does that answer your question?
Oh, I mean, from your perspective, yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you. Now we have a 10-minute cross-examination of Abdullah by Jason.
Okay. Well, let's get to perhaps what's our biggest disagreement. Firstly, I hope you believe I did not do this intentionally. I did my best to understand correctly, but you nonetheless obviously think that I have misunderstood what the Quran says about the ideal. Could you please clarify and tell us what, in your opinion, Surah Al-Ma'idah, is that pronounced correctly?
Yeah. Or
says about the Injil.
So that's one verse of many. I guess the first thing that people need to understand about the Qur'an, if they haven't read it before, they're not familiar with it, is that the Qur'an is not in chronological order. You know, we wouldn't be able to sort of subtitle chapters of the Qur'an and say, this is where God is talking about X or Y, you know, as we find in some very nice printings of the Judeo-Christian scriptures. So when we have roughly 5-6 statements in the Quran that refer to the Judeo-Christian scriptures, we have to appreciate that the Quran explains itself. So we combine the statements into one teaching. Now, the statements are not contradictory. That's the critical thing to understand. And I gave the example of the story of the Pharaoh of Moses, which is often quoted. Another one that's often quoted as an example of a contradiction in the Quran is where the Quran refers to the creation occurring in 6 days in one account, and it then refers to a portion of creation taking 4 days, another portion of creation taking 2 days, and another portion taking 2 days. Now, the point is we say, well, the base teaching is clear. The creation was 6 days. We don't interpret that in the young earth creationist understanding, by the way. And again, that's from the Quran, because there's a statement which says that a day for your Lord is 50,000 years or more of your reckoning. So the point is, we have a base teaching, and then we then have supplementary verses which complement it and explain it. And so when we have the base teaching with regards to the Christian scriptures, or the Judeo-Christian scriptures, which is that they are corrupted, and that's referred to in multiple verses. There's verses that refer to the understanding being corrupted, and then there's a single verse that refers to the written text being corrupted. That's the base teaching. And then from there we have supplementary teaching. So the supplementary teachings are that the Quran has come to affirm what truth is contained within them, and that Christians or Jews could then read what they still have to then be able to recognise what is the truth, basically. So, you know, when we have the majority of Mark's Gospel, which I'm sure you would agree presents a very human Jesus, we would say that, well, that's affirmed by the Quran, ergo it's true. And so that's sort of what's happening.
Okay. If in fact the Gospels that the Christians have contain so much corruption, how could we in fact read them? Because, okay, again, perhaps I'm misunderstanding, but it does seem at least to me that the Quran is saying to, you know, read what you have in your scriptures and affirm the truth of what we are saying. How could he do that? How could we be expected to do that if in fact the scriptures we have contain all this corruption?
Yeah, it's a good question, and maybe I didn't emphasise it clearly enough. The Quran does indeed say to read what's between your hands, but it says that the Quran is the protector, the witness of them. And so what it's saying is use the Quran as a yardstick. So anything that's affirmed by the Quran is true. Anything which is refuted by the Quran is false. And then anything which is neutral we'd consider to be possible or, you know, speculative, I guess.
Okay. So when he says judge what's within him, what do you think he's asking us to judge? Do you think he's in fact asking us to judge his claims of revelation? Do you think that the Quran is asking us to judge to see whether it's correct or not?
As in to judge if the Quran is correct?
Yes.
Well, that's certainly one interpretation that's taken. Another interpretation that's taken is that I guess ultimately the end game, is to emphasise that the Quran, to realise that the Quran is true. But sort of the mechanism which is applied here is to take the Quran, what it says about Jesus, for example, to then read what you have between your hands, what that says about Jesus, and to then basically then decide for yourself. And see, that's the big thing about the Quran. You know, the Quran says, and it was a verse that I put up that I didn't read out, that, you know, don't be like those who follow blindly and jump upon Scripture as if they are deaf and blind. And the point of that is that, you know, we don't believe in blind following. You know, for us, it's all about assessing truth, assessing evidence. And if we want to make a claim, particularly one that's as important as our eternal salvation, we need to support that with some degree of evidence. So I guess what the Quran is ultimately asking the Christian to do is look at what the Quran says about what you already believe, then look at what your scriptures say, and then make a decision for yourself. Does that make sense?
Okay, thank you. That does. When the Quran talks about the Injil and says that the Injil was a revelation which is guidance and light, what do you understand that to be referring to?
Well, certainly not to the Gospels themselves. And see, this is another critical thing. You know, the Quran actually goes at pains to basically describe the terms that it uses so that they will be understood by the appropriate audience in the appropriate manner. So in this instance, we're referring to the direct revelation given to Jesus. Now, the Gospel accounts do refer to Jesus preaching the Gospel. Now, obviously, he wasn't preaching the Gospel according to St. Mark, St. Matthew, St. Luke, and St. John. He was preaching whatever the Gospel was. And I guess the Christian would say that, well, that gospel is now preserved in the four accounts. We would say that it's not, and there's not even any evidence that that is the case. So when the Quran refers to the Injil, it's referring to the revelation that we believe was given to Jesus. Peace be upon him.
Okay. So you, but you, you, again, I'm a bit confused here as to how it can be the case that if the Injil is Jesus' preaching, how can we be asked to judge based if our Gospels do not in fact project?
Very simple answer to that question. The verse that you're referring to does not say judge by the Injil that you have between your hands. It says judge by the book that you have between your hands. And that's basically where the Quran often makes the distinction, distinguishing between the revelation that was given to Jesus and the book that you have in your hand, even though Christians are referred to as people of the gospel and so on. There is a very, very clear distinction, and never does it say, read the gospel that you have, it says, read the book that you have.
Okay, if in fact we don't have the gospels, why are we called the people of the gospel in the Quran?
Well, again, the general term is people of the book, you know, the people of the gospel only comes up twice, I think. Again, we have a base teaching, and then we'll have an explanation. And perhaps that distinction is used, I'd have to look at some exegeses, but perhaps that distinction there is used to then differentiate between the Jews and the Christians. I'd have to look at it.
Okay.
But certainly the point is, the verse that you're referring to talks about the book that you have in your hand. It doesn't name the gospel.
Okay. Would you say that the Torah and the Psalms have undergone similar corruption?
I would, yeah. And again, I think that there's significant evidence for that. I'd quote the documentary hypothesis, you know, to demonstrate that. I think that there's significant evidence for that. It's all right, it's just romantic lighting now. That's the Orthodox Muslim opinion.
One final question then, if the Torah, the Psalms and the Gospel, which were all God's Word and God's divine revelation, have been allowed to undergo such corruption, what guarantee do we have that the Quran has not or will not in the future undergo similar corruption?
That's a very good question, and it's important that we note the distinction between the Quran as God's Word and the earlier revelations as God's Word. We believe that the Quran is the literal speech of God, in the sense that Moses heard the speech of God. We don't believe that the earlier scriptures had that status, and there's a very simple reason for that, and it's because it's never affirmed in the Quran. Now, bearing that in mind, it's very easy to appreciate a distinction. Now, having said that, if you ultimately want to say, well, there's still a text, and how did one text undergo corruption and the other one didn't? Well, the Quran, again, answers... Do you want me to finish the question? Or close? Yeah, okay. The Quran, again, answers that. It says that... God says in the Quran that he is protecting the Quran. Now, as for why he didn't protect the earlier revelations, well, you know, I mean, that's... You know, that's living in the mind of the divine, and it's not something that's touched on in Islamic theology, so it's not something that I'd only be speculating, you know. How do we have proof? Well, we can just even look at documentary evidence, you know, manuscript evidence and that sort of stuff, and see that the actual text and recitation of the Quran have been maintained quite uniquely, and the Judeo-Christian scriptures, not so much.
Thank you to both speakers. Now we have questions from the audience. If you do have a question, please come forward now and line up as I described. I think from memory I said that those questions that are for Jason, those questioners, please line up near the desk, and those questions for Abdullah line up near the wall. We have around half an hour for questions. Depending on how late we're running, I might cut it short, so that's up to me. But I'll stop talking and get the questions flowing. So a question for Jason, 20 seconds only. Thanks.
I suppose it's maybe a given question for people well-read in the scriptures, or who know a little more than me. But for the benefit of everyone, I suppose, could you explain, Jason, the scriptural tradition with some examples from the scriptures that have produced this teaching of three persons? And could you explain the purpose or God's intention in having this division once again through scripture?
Well, I can't explain God's intention because I don't believe it is God's intention. Christians don't believe... Perhaps I misunderstood your question slightly, but you kind of get the impression that you think that Christians sort of think that God decided he would be three persons. That's certainly not his intention. It's simply a case that that is who God is. Yeah. As to why he chose to act in the way he did, ultimately God acts the way God chooses to act, and he has not seen fit to reveal his reasons in all things. As to the tradition behind that, I would affirm that Scripture teaches that the Father is God. I also affirm, for the reasons I laid out in my opening statement, Scripture teaches that the Son is God. However, at the same time, Scripture clearly teaches that the Son is not the Father. The Son prays to the Father. The Son talks about following the will of the Father. So it affirms that both of these persons are God. In the same way, going into a very short time, but the Scriptures, for instance, the Holy Spirit, is spoken of as having a distinct will. It is spoken, the Holy Spirit is prayed to, the Holy Spirit is spoken of as having a temple and various other things that imply that the Holy Spirit is deity.
Yeah.
And yet it is clearly taught to be separate and distinct.
I just wanted to clarify perhaps that it's not just an arbitrary thing that we're having to defend for its own sake.
Yeah.
I think
we can't have rebuttals.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Rebuttal.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Oh, sorry, Abdullah gets...
60 seconds.
Yes.
Oh, to reply. I think it's a very good question, because I ultimately think that there's very little scriptural evidence, in particular coming from the Hebrew scriptures or the Old Testament, even in the Catholic Apocrypha, there's very little evidence to indicate this idea. Abraham, for example, did not speak to the Son, and to the Spirit, and to the Father, and we can go on from that. I think that it's an essential idea that really needs to be clarified and affirmed, and I think isn't really a maintainable position that there is scriptural evidence for the Trinity or the triune nature of God.
A question for Abdullah.
It's a pretty quick historical question. If Jesus was rescued from death or taken up to heaven, which is what you said in your earlier speech, why does all the historical evidence suggest otherwise? And why is the burden of proof put on the Christian Gospels where the same proof isn't put on the Quran, in the sense that it seems you can only ever refer to the Quran and not to any other historical evidence for the Quran's claims?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that the first point to note is, whether Jesus ascended into heaven or not is actually something that we would agree upon. We agree about the ascension. So in terms of the historical evidence for that, well, I would say that there effectively is none. The historical evidence is the gospel accounts. And herein, the Quran is just affirming something that's written in the gospel accounts. So I'm not really sure what other historical evidence we would need to have in order to reach an agreement on that point, because I know that we both agree on the ascension. Having said that, you then also said, well, why is the Quran not held to this standard of secular history, I guess, for lack of a better term? Well, the thing is, because when it comes to the nature of Jesus, and this is the critical question, the Quran is not making a claim which is unique. The Quran is not saying that Jesus is God and man, or the God-man, or whatever. The Quran says that Jesus was born in Palestine approximately 2,000 years ago. and that he's fully a human being. Now, do we need historical evidence to prove that people were born in Palestine 2,000 years ago? I don't think so. Do we need historical evidence perhaps to prove that specific personalities did exist? Well, it would be nice. And, you know, we can look at other claims. But ultimately, I guess, we hold the Quran to be true for other reasons other than its historical claims. In particular, its claim of uniqueness and inimitability. And, you know, we would consider the Gospels to not be true for the converse reason. And I think that answers the question. Thank you.
Look, I think the historical evidence for the crucifixion is really overwhelming. Abdullah asked about first century evidence. We may dispute whether or not the Gospels call Jesus God. No one can dispute the Gospels, all written in the first century, say he was crucified. No one disputes that St. Paul, writing in the first century, said he was crucified. No one disputes that the epistles of St. Peter, first century, say he was crucified. And what is more, the enemies of Christianity. We have evidence of very early Christian dialogues with Jewish enemies of Christianity who do not dispute that Jesus was crucified. The pagan Roman historians who are critical of Christianity, who say every nasty thing about Christianity you can imagine, do not dispute that Jesus was crucified. The only people prior to Muhammad who dispute that Jesus was crucified are the Gnostics. And the reason they dispute that, they are certainly no friends of Islam, the reason they dispute that is they deny he was man and don't think he had a human body, which could have been crucified.
Question for Abdullah.
As Abdullah says that Muslims can accept some verses from the Bible, I find one good verse here, a very nice one, which I want to read, which is Romans 10:17. It says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So my question, depending on this verse, Christian believes that Jesus came to earth for saving human from the Pharisee. So I want you to quote for me anywhere in the Bible where Jesus, peace be upon him, speaks about the Pharisee.
Where Jesus talks about?
The Pharisee. Quote for, from Jesus' words.
I don't believe Jesus directly teach the doctrine of original sin. I do happen to believe that doctrine, but I certainly don't believe that Jesus I don't see any evidence I don't know that Jesus directly taught that doctrine. I believe it is true, but it can be true without Jesus directly teaching it. And it's, you know, all due respect, the topic of tonight's debate is that Jesus is God, not original sin. If Sumsa would like to organise another debate about original sin, we can talk about that. But original sin can be true without Jesus needing to directly teach it. Jesus had apostles and established a church to teach. So, yeah, I can believe in original sin without believing that Jesus directly taught it.
So there's no good.
No, there's not.
I guess I'm sort of responding to the answer to the question, which again wasn't sort of directly related to the topic, but I guess it does sort of touch on an overarching theme, which I'll repeat again and again. What ultimately is the evidence for the claims that are being made? And indeed, Christians would affirm that the Apostle Peter wrote that we must be at all times capable of defending or giving a reason for the hope that we have. And I think that if the Christian, and indeed the Catholic, the Roman Catholic, who holds that St. Peter is the rock upon which Jesus built his church, then if the Christian really wants to follow this command, basically, this instruction, then they have to be willing to give a little bit of evidence for the actual issue that we're discussing tonight. I accept that original sin is not the issue that we're discussing tonight, so a bit difficult for Jason to be expected to answer questions on the gamut of Christian theology.
I guess this links into Lawrence's question a bit, but Corinthians says that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. And Professor James Dunn of the University of Durham says that this tradition, we can be entirely confident, was formulated as tradition within months of Jesus' death. So if the Islamic interpretation of Jesus' last days on earth is to be correct, then how do they account for the early Christians getting it wrong within months of, post-factum?
You know what, that's a brilliant question, and I love the wording of it, because I think you've sort of trapped yourself a little bit, I must say. Because if that idea was formulated within months, well then this quote from Corinthians cannot be accurate, because according to what scriptures did the Messiah die, or would he die and be resurrected on the third day? The only scriptures that those concepts are contained within are the New Testament scriptures, and we know that they did not exist at that time. You know, the gospel accounts did not exist at the time at which Paul was writing the letter to the Corinthians. So this very idea indicates the whole problem with the evidence that has been presented by the Christian side. Jason?
I assume every Christian knows what I'm by response to this. When St. Paul says, according to the scriptures, what St. Paul is testifying to is the fact that the death of the suffering and death of the Messiah, as well as his resurrection, is prophesied in the Old Testament. He is referring, for example, to the 22nd Psalm. He is referring to the suffering servant songs in Isaiah. And it is whether or not St. Paul's claim is true is an entirely separate issue. I obviously believe they were, but what St. Paul is claiming there is not this is recorded in the New Testament scriptures, which, as Abdullah says, don't exist yet. What he's saying is this was foretold in the scriptures which the Jewish people already possess.
Question for Jason.
So the subject of today's discussion is Jesus God? But apparently in Christian theology we know that there's the concept that Jesus is also the Son of God. So my question is, how can Jesus both be God and the Son of God? So did he beget himself? And if so, what is exactly meant by the word begotten? As we know, begotten is the lower animalistic function of sex. So what does it actually mean that Jesus, that God begot Jesus?
Okay, firstly, the Son of God means two quite separate and distinct things. Firstly, it is a reference to, as I said, there are three, within the one being, there are three persons of God. This is who are God. The term Son of God firstly describes the eternal relationship that exists between the Son and the Father. Now, why do we use the term begotten? We're certainly not suggesting that God the Father had sex with some heavenly mother to produce the Son. We use the term begotten firstly because the Son is dependent for his eternal existence, eternally begotten, upon the Father. And secondly, as C.S. Lewis so beautifully put it, what you make is something different from yourself. What you beget is like yourself. A man makes a statue, an iPhone, whatever. He begets another human being. In the same way, God the Father has made many things. He begets the Son, who is the second person of the Trinity and fully God. Secondly, he is the Son of God because of the inferior position that he, in a sense, willingly assumed when he took on the nature of a human being and, as St. Paul says, became humble himself, becoming like a servant here on earth. But it primarily refers to his eternal relationship with the Father. And therefore, no, I don't believe there is any contradiction in affirming him to be both God and Son of God.
I think it indicates the problem with the terminology as it's understood by Christians. So we know that God is reported to have said to David that he has begotten him, today he has begotten him. We know that there's a quote in the Hebrew Scriptures where one of the prophets say to God, "Before you begot the mountains." Okay, this idea about it being unique to Jesus is absolutely not present. Certainly, the idea that it's animalistic and has that literal connotation, to be fair, is also not present. But ultimately the issue is for the Christian to define as to why it's unique to Jesus. Why does the same thing not apply to David when it's mentioned? Why does the same thing not apply to the mountains, you know, when it's mentioned by the prophets? It just indicates that the terminology, again, is used when it's convenient, refuted when it's not convenient,
Next question.
Thank you. Virgil's Aeneid has not changed, and it was written before the Quran and the Gospels. Second to that, no text is self-authenticating. It is not enough to say that it is the word of God because it says so. How does the Quran justify its claims? And secondly, Jason, you could answer how would Scripture justify its claims to being the word of God?
Okay. Well, the Quran is very simple. It says in numerous places that it is inimitable. That is, that there cannot be something produced like it, like its content, like its beauty, like its uniqueness. And the challenge is laid out to individuals to do so and falsify this claim. And it's actually laid out in a couple of places in the Quran. And the fact that we've got through 1400 or so years and no one's measured up to this claim yet, despite many attempts, the most recent of which some Christians may know of, called the true Furqan, is evidence for us of its reliability. There are other things that we also have as evidence for its reliability, and that is that everything that it says is true. So, for example, when it says that alcohol has some benefit, but that the benefit is outweighed by the negative, we know that today to be an absolute reality, quite contradictory to what St. Paul says in the epistles. On the same subject. We know, for example, that the historical facts that it refers to are reality. So I guess because we don't have anything to affirm that is false, and also ultimately because it is inimitable, hasn't been emulated at all, that for us is the evidence.
I'm sorry, John, I'm not in the 60 seconds allotted to be going to spell out the case for the reliability of the Christian scriptures. That's another worthy of a debate in its own right, and again, one that I'd be happy to do. I will simply say in response to that that a lot of the Muslim claims for the uniqueness of the Quran, for instance, talking about the challenge to create something that is equal to the Quran in its beauty, it seems to me that beauty of a literary text, some people would claim that's entirely subjective. I don't. I actually acknowledge there is such a thing as objective beauty, but verifying exactly what it is incredibly difficult. And I think to get an objectively verifiable claim that this one literary text is more beautiful or equal in beauty to some other is such a subjective claim. And many of the other claims, I think, would be highly debated, that Abdullah put forward would be highly debated, to say the least.
I'll allow time for two more questions, so sorry to those who are at the back, but that's all we have time for, so these two gentlemen.
Yeah,
thank
you very much. Jason, Abdullah, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum. It simply means, peace be upon you. Is the best greeting you can have. So Jason, I've got a question for you. As you said in your opening talk, God as a man suffered on the cross. It's a very confusing statement. And it would be very hard to sell in 21st century. God was a man was a God. Can you define God in simple English? Who's your God?
Well,
can I define my God first? Then you have a chance to define your God?
Remember, only 20 seconds.
Yeah.
Yes. God is one. The creator of the heavens and the earth. And the God who is the creator of all the prophets. Adam and Eve, Prophet Abraham, Prophet Moses, Prophet Jesus, Prophet Muhammad, Isaac, Noah, Jacob, Mary. Peace be upon them. We believe in all of them, and God is one and unique. God is not a man, and man is not a God. Can you define your God, please, in simple English, the way I defined you?
Firstly, you say it's a difficult sell in the 21st century. It's been a difficult sell since it was first played. It was hard to believe. The gospel was hard to believe when it was first preached. It's been hard to believe ever since. That's one of the reasons we need the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, that we may be brought to faith. We ask you to believe a difficult thing. We do not dispute this. I would actually agree with the vast majority of your definition. I mean, I said in my rebuttal that I agree with the vast majority. In fact, I agree with pretty much everything where Abdullah was talking about the qualities that God has and who he is. What I've maintained is that there is no necessary contradiction between that one God or one of the persons who make up that one God being united in a hypostatic union with a perishable nature. And that doesn't change the fact that the person is eternal, the person is necessary, the person continues to have all those qualities.
It's touched on a critical difference between Islam and Christianity, and that is that when Islam is presenting our theology, and indeed when the Quran is presenting theology, it says, think, learn, understand, and then faith will be easy for you. Now, the idea that I get from Christians is that it's the opposite, that we need to have the Spirit come upon us, we have faith, and then we'll be able to understand. Okay? For us, it's a stark difference. And I think that ultimately it keeps coming back to this sort of false reduplicative argument, that is that something can have mutually separate attributes which are also contradictory, which I don't think demonstrates anything.
Last question for Dr. Early in the talk, Jason gave an argument. He said that apparent contradictions, which do arise from Jesus being both God and man, do not actually amount to a logical contradiction for the following reason. He says that what is said of a part of a thing is true of the thing, and therefore a thing can actually hold apparently contradictory attributes in virtue of its parts without actually causing a contradiction. And it seems that you reject this reasoning, which is very crucial because it, you know, forms a very important part of the whole Catholic argument. So my question to you is, when a human person dies, any human person, does that mean that every part of him actually dies? Does his spirit die? Or do humans just not die in truth?
It's a good question. I'll answer both parts because it's basically a two-part question. So the first part is, can something have attributes which are seemingly contradictory but that it doesn't affect what it is itself? Now the issue here is that we need to get back to base terms, and that's why I was defining what is an essence, what is a person, etc. Now if something as an essence has attribute X and Y is not a subset of X and X is not a subset of Y, then it cannot then have the attribute Y. Right? Does that make sense in basic algebraic terms? So to put it into words, if God has the attributes of being God, and we went through them, then all the attributes of being human are not a subset of that. And all the attributes of being divine are not a subset of being human. So it's not just a matter of having attributes which are apparently contradictory, it's attributes which are indeed contradictory. Now to then apply that to your question, when a person dies, does that mean that every aspect of them dies? Well, no, it doesn't. But that's because the essence of the human being is made up of attributes X, Y, Z. It's made up of a physical body. It's made up of an everlasting soul, personality, etc., etc. And we would both agree that the physical body is not necessary for the existence of the other attributes. Now, if I said to you that, yes, a human being is made up of these things, but that he or she can now also take on an attribute of not having any being whatsoever, no being whatsoever, not a physical body, not an incorporeal body. Well, then you would say, well, no, that's absolutely contradictory. And that's the reason why it is contradictory.
I guess what I come down to is, Abdullah seems to believe, and I think that the incarnation means that God is both eternal and temporal, that God is both necessary and not necessary. God is necessary and God is eternal. The second person of the Trinity is necessary and the second person of the Trinity is eternal. The second person of the Trinity has been joined to a nature which is not eternal. The second person of the Trinity has been joined to a nature which is not necessary. And what I would, I guess, keep coming back to is that no, it is, you know, for instance, my hand is really small, less than a foot. I am taller than 5 feet. I don't think anyone would suggest that that is a logical contradiction. My hand is a part of me. The divine nature, the divine person is what it is. The nature is not.
That brings us to the end of the question. So I think we've got... And also a big thank you to those who put their hands up and came up to ask questions. Sorry we didn't get through all of them. We still have 10 minutes left. That is the closing remarks. 5 minutes each. So I will invite Jason to give his final statement, followed by Abdullah.
Thank you very much to everyone who's come along. I think it's been a really good discussion, and I appreciate everyone who's been a part of it. Summarising it in 5 minutes is not going to be easy. Abdullah, God willing, next time we do this, I think longer than 5 minutes on the summary. But I just want to say, firstly, as regard to logic, to repeat the point, the divine nature and the divine person and the two natures who make that up are quite separate and distinct issues. And I've said this repeatedly, I'll hammer it one last time. My hand, very small, much less than a foot. Me, taller than 5 feet. That's not a logical contradiction. In the same way, to say the second person of the Trinity is necessary and unnecessary would be a contradiction. To say the second person of the Trinity is eternal but is joined to a nature which is not eternal is not a logical contradiction. Secondly, I appreciate Abdullah's efforts to clarify how Muslims understand the passage from the Quran that I cited early in the debate. However, it still seems to me that if you are asking the people to judge by the book that is in their hands, what is in their hands must bear some relationship to the original revelation. And I think it must, for the judgment to be meaningful, it must bear a greater relationship than Abdullah has been willing to concede tonight. And what I would still suggest and argue is that the Quran clearly, the author of the Quran, who by his own admission was illiterate, expected that the gospel, believed that the gospels would corroborate his claim to a much greater extent than in fact they do. Because Abdullah and I can debate the precise meanings of this or that passage. There's no question the Gospels declare that Jesus was worshipped and that he accepted worship. There is no question that the Gospels declare that Jesus was crucified. There is no question that the letters of Paul of Tarsus declare that Jesus was crucified. And what I suggest to you is that these, you know, and those documents we may dispute, you know, and there were church fathers as well. Clement of Rome, very probably first century. The other church fathers, all right, second century, but very early second century. Melito of Sardis, the first decade of the second century. What we are being asked, now Abdullah brings up the question, well, you can have a great teacher who just has really bad students. But what I'm suggesting is that for the message of Jesus to become so corrupt that quickly really requires something that is beyond belief. That from one end of the empire to the other, they could be claiming so early that he was crucified for our sins, that he died, and that he was, as you know, Melito Sardis calls him, our God, really does defy belief. So I want to very quickly, in the minute and a half that's left to me, directly address those Muslims in the audience. I thank you very much for your patience and your attendance tonight. Abdullah said that he did not intend to offend any of the Christians in the audience. I likewise certainly have no intention or desire to offend you, and I am sorry if I have to any extent done so. But I must leave you with this thought. I believe that the Gospels, I believe that the history of the Church makes a very clear and compelling case that Jesus is God. If any of you would like to discuss this further, I'd like to extend an invitation to you. Take a look. You can drop in. Please feel free to drop in any time. The John Paul II Student Centre, which is right across the road from Victoria Park. You can't miss it. It's above the shop with a statue of the Virgin Mary in the window. Or look up the Catholic Society of St. Peter online. We would very much love to dialogue, either myself or our chaplain or one of our wonderful religious sisters would very much love to speak to any of you about Jesus anytime. Because I believe all of us want to know God, who he truly is. And there was an event where a man declared to the famous Catholic theologian Cardinal Newman, "I worship God in my own way," to which Cardinal Newman replied, "Oh really, I worship God in God's way." I think all of us in this room are here because we want to worship God in God's way, not according to our own beliefs, but as God wishes to be worshipped. And I submit to you that to truly do that, you must worship him as Trinity and must worship him incarnate in the person of Jesus.
I'd like to echo the thanks that Jason has extended tonight. It's not easy to listen to someone talk about your religion as not being true. However, just because it's not easy doesn't mean that we shouldn't be doing it. In fact, quite the opposite, we should be doing it. Now, to ultimately give the invitation that I should give and also answer the question about the Quran at the same time, the Quran wants you to read it and also to think about what you've been taught yourself, and to come to your own decision. Now, just because you come to a decision that's different to the Quran doesn't mean that your decision is true, or it's true for you. Remember I said at the start, we don't believe that. Okay, there's truth, and there's something else. But the Quran wants you to read it, and then to read, as Christians, what you hold to be true, and then come to your own conclusion. Now, if the best evidence that you can provide for the divinity of Jesus is that, well, people almost 100 years after the time of Jesus affirmed it to be true, and they existed in different parts of the Roman Empire, and therefore, well, it must have been known. If that's the best evidence that you can provide, I can provide counter evidence to the same degree. I can say, well, there were equal amounts of people in the empire who affirmed that Jesus was not divine, and hence why, there was the first disagreements between Athanasius and Arius. Okay? We know that that was a reality. In fact, we know that Arian Christians existed until the time that the Muslims liberated Spain in the 8th century. So the idea that just all Christians have always believed what the Council of Chalcedon laid down is false. Okay? And the idea that there's evidence for it that precedes Jesus in the Hebrew Scriptures is false. And the idea that there's any evidence for it between Jesus and roughly about at least 50 years after, independent evidence that is, after his ascension is also false. And these are realities. Now these are realities that you as a Christian need to reconcile. I as a Muslim don't. Okay, my challenge would be different. It would be to justify my faith in the Quran. Okay, but you have to justify your faith in the divinity of Jesus. And if the best evidence that you can give is the examples that I just gave, well, I think that you're making a decision which is absolutely a leap of faith and nothing more. Okay? If the second best evidence that you can give is the gospel accounts, well, that would be akin to me saying that somewhere in the north of England there's an invisible castle that we muggles can't see because it's written down in a book. That's not evidence. Just because it's written doesn't make it evidence.
You know, Plato wrote down in a book that the lost island of Atlantis existed, and it was technologically thousands of years ahead of the rest of humanity. People still hold to this idea today. Okay? A false teaching. You just made it up. It's spread around the entire world, and now I speak about it, I don't need to explain it because we've all heard of it. So don't use what is at best circumstantial arguments and absolutely illogical arguments to justify what should be really the most important thing to you. I thank you all very much for your time and your patience, and I also extend the invitation on the other side that if you would like to know more about Islam, the Muslim Students Association of this campus is very well equipped to be able to deal with any questions that you may have, and you can either head down to the prayer rooms or come and see us when we have tables and whatnot set up. We'd be more than happy to have a chat. Thank you all very much. As-salamu alaykum.
That draws us to the end of tonight's debate. Thank you to the Catholic Society of St. Peter for hosting the event. Thank you to Sydney University Muslim Association for also promoting the event and attending, and for all those attending. A very specific thank you to Rita Azzi from the Catholic Society, who's spent a lot of time actually planning the nuts and bolts of this event. And also a big... and a big thank you from my point of view, being involved in the early stages, to Jason for discussing the idea with Abdullah and coming up with the idea. So thank you to both of you, and we have two gifts for you.